Normally, I don't like doing tutorials on techniques already covered by others, but in this case, I had to make an exception. The pixel stretch effect was invented a while ago, and there are many ways of creating it in Photoshop. In this video, I will show you my approach, which might be the most efficient and non-destructive way of creating these fun compositions. So, we are going to work on the lady on the left, but I wanted to show you two different versions of the same method, and we will go through step by step everything. So, I'm going to show you my approach to create this pixel stretch with the bend effect. And I was inspired by Joe Cavazos. You can find his Instagram and you can see he has been doing this type of art for a while, and he's doing it amazingly. So he's combining this sometimes with the polar coordinates when he's creating these more circular pixel stretches. But what we are going to focus on today is the linear stretch. I've seen his tutorials and he's doing it in a very unique and cool way, but I think I came up with another, maybe even faster way and easier way to create this stretch. So let me walk you through my method or workflow. So as I said, I'm going to focus on this one here. So I'm just going to switch to see that full. And I am going to turn off all the design that I created. And I will just start with the image itself, which I already masked out, and I have a good color background. I'm using color fill layer for that, and you can always add gradients if you wanted to, but I'm just going to keep it flat for this example. Now, one thing I wanted to show you before I go any further, if I just go back a few steps, is that you can see here we have a few interesting colors as well in the stretch. They are red, but there shouldn't be any red in the image. If we zoom a little bit closer, you can see that I left some details from the original background by accident, and that caused these reds to show up. Also here, where it's supposed to be mainly purely black, there's some white lines going through, and it could look actually quite cool because it adds some texture, but the selection itself is not perfect. Again, that's what's causing those white or gray lines to show in the stretch itself. So this is important at the beginning to make sure that your selection is good enough. Now, I created a smart object, so if I double click inside the smart object, that's where my actual selection is, and there's the mask that I created. When you have a layer mask, you can just Alt or Option click on it to see it. And I'm going to stay in the normal view, and I will just put a white background behind it, or even something like a different color. Let's just use a color, solid color layer, so we can set it up. I like to use a color in the background because I can spot the mistakes better. And I'm going to zoom a bit closer and use the brush tool and just simply paint over these edges. So if I want to have no gray lines showing up, or a little bit less than we have here, then I can tidy this up. I'm not going to spend too much time on it. I'm just wanted to show you, and mainly these reds here I wanted to get rid of. Now, if you want to have a better selection, you can always use a vector mask, or even if you started using a pixel mask, you can still use the pen tool in path mode. So when you use it with path, you just draw over. I'm just going to change the color again because otherwise you wouldn't see what I'm doing. Let's just go yellow for now. And you will see what I'm doing here is using the pen tool, holding down the space bar to position my anchor point while I'm still drawing it, and dragging out the handles, trying to create the curve that's necessary here. So I'm going to create the curve to something around that, then come up here, again, holding down the space bar to move this point around until I find the right position for it, and then come all the way up and create a closed little shape here. Then press Command or Control Enter to turn this into a selection. And then within the mask, I can fill this in with black. And if you have your black as your foreground color, you just press Alt or Option Backspace. So that's fill with foreground color. Or you can even use the brush tool and just paint over it. So if I go back, I can even paint over this detail here. Now, if I feel like it still has a bit of redness, I can even use the left arrow on the keyboard to push my selection slightly to the left and then paint over it again. So it's basically carving out from it a bit more, and I can go a little bit closer here, maybe with a smaller brush, and just paint over it, maybe there as well a bit. Okay, so that's much neater and tidier, you can see from a distance. Thanks to the pen tool and that selection, we created a beautiful curve, and of course it would look much better if I tidied it up further all along the lines, but for now I think that will work. So I can just tidy this bit up here as well, maybe around here, and so on and so forth. Now you need to decide which side you want the stretch to go. So because the movement feels like she's moving forward, I would probably put the stretch behind her. But we could also make it look like she's falling backwards and then the stretch can go on the left. It's really up to you how you interpret a posture and the movement. I'm going to turn off this color fill, save my smart object, close it, and then we have now the refined version here in the main comp. And it's interesting that if you want to have the stretch going on the right, so you want to stretch it that way, you should actually start the stretch to the left. You will see why. So I'm going to position the lady here on the right, the model, and I'm going to start doing the stretch. It's very simple. So this is the cool part. You hold down Option or Alt key and then press left arrow in case you want to start it left. So I'm going to press left arrow once. Then this layer we can rasterize. It doesn't need to be a smart object anymore. So right click, rasterize layer. By the way, smart object, to create one when you start off, you just right click and choose convert to smart object. In another video I explain, if you haven't seen it already, that the best workflow is to first create your mask, then save it as a smart object, the whole layer, so the mask inside the smart object, and then start making transformations. That's like the general three steps of working with layers non-destructively. So now that I have that, I can just actually delete these layers so they are not in the way. So we have the dancer layer here, and all the other layers I'm just going to work temporarily with. So this one has already been moved slightly to the left, just one pixel. That was the left arrow. But then I hold down again the Option and Shift or Alt Shift together, and now I'm using the left arrow again. But because I add Shift, I'm going to create duplicates 10 pixels away from the original one. So it pushes it or nudges it 10 pixels to the side. So when I keep doing this, you will see what's happening here. I'm going to zoom a little bit closer so you can see it better. It's actually creating each time when I'm doing that a duplicate layer. So I can keep doing this. I can even keep holding down the left arrow and it just creates that transition. Now I'm going to go back a bit. It doesn't need to go that far. So something like that's already enough for us, because what we will do now is to turn off the original layer. So I'm just going to turn that off so it doesn't get in the way. And I'm going to hold down the Command or Control key and click on the top layer's thumbnail. So by doing that, we made a selection on the top layer, and then select all of these duplicate layers apart from the original smart object and merge them together with Control or Command E. That created the merge. And now with the selection that we have, we just simply press backspace or delete. And this basically got rid of the top detail. And now we only have the stretch details on the side. So with this layer, we can create another duplicate easily if we wanted to. But normally the duplicate I would put underneath the original one, just to make sure that we avoid any gaps. And you can even it out if you want, but it's not really that necessary. And you need to continue doing this until you get a straight line. But what you can do also is that you don't need to continue too much this stretch. You can also just simply select, let's say, this bottom half here. It doesn't really matter where. Let's say we select it here, and holding down the Command key, we can just move it along. Command and Shift is better to be held together, because that way you will get a perfect horizontal movement. So we will just try to align all of these details in one vertical row here as well. I think now if I put down a guide, that can help us to see whether we get a perfect alignment. It's not there yet. So on the top, we have it right. But on the bottom, I'm still going to push this one a bit further. So I'm just going to get this one moved along, and then also this detail here can move along. All right, so along that guide, we can see now we have a vertical line. And what I'm going to do is to switch to the single column marquee tool, with which we can just simply click where the guide is. Now, this is something you might not see only once you get rid of the guide. So I'm just going to clear the guides. So there's that single pixel column selected. And I'm going to use a shortcut, Command or Control J. Once I've done that, that's actually a layer via copy shortcut, which means that we snapped all of those pixels from the original stretch. Now I can turn back the dancer layer. I can move her here on the left where I wanted her, and then select this new layer, which I'm just going to call stretch, and then use the free transform tool, Control or Command T, and then holding down the Alt or Option key and the Shift together, we stretch this out. Once we press Enter, it will show up. So sometimes you will see straight away, depending on your zoom. Sometimes you will only see the result once you let go. And that's the cool part of the whole technique. This is when you start seeing how it's going to look like. But we can move this underneath the dancer and we can check that everything is aligned. So I like to see this properly, that we have the white details here continuing, we have the socks, the yellow bits, then the black, then again the yellow of the socks, then the trouser, and we can see that I still left a few white details in there, but I don't mind that, it actually adds some textural quality to the whole thing. And then we come up here, we can see the hair details as well, and then on the top it's the hand with the nail coming out. So everything is in place and we have a perfect stretch created. Now it's all about creating the bend on this. Before we continue, I just wanted to let you know about our creative membership program. For a small monthly fee, you get access to over 200 hours of Adobe certified online training courses. Master all the tools and skills needed to become a professional graphic designer or illustrator. As a pro member, you will get mentoring from me and my team, access to webinars, student forum, and creative briefs to help you build an outstanding portfolio. Pro members can also download the project files for all of our YouTube tutorials. Sign up at yesimadesigner.com/memberships and start your free trial today. And now, let's head back to the tutorial. So we can position it somewhere around here. Let's just keep it here for now. And I'm going to zoom out because we need quite a lot of space for this, what I'm going to do next. I like to turn the stretch layer into a smart object as well. I'm going to right click and choose Convert to Smart Object, because that allows us to later come back and refine the warp that we will apply. So once again, it's Command or Control T for free transform. Stretch it even further out if you want. And then the most important thing is to switch to warp. So once you have the warp option on, you will see these little handles showing up. And with them, basically what you can do is start pulling one side and flip it onto the other side. So that's the crucial bit that we need to create here. So I will probably do it the other way around. So something like that is maybe a little bit too far. So I'm going to mess around a bit, squeeze this up, then pull that down. Yeah, that's something similar to what I've done in the other example. So I'm going to keep it around there. One important thing to remember is that you will have to go back and align the left side, because already we can see that there's a couple of misaligned details there, but don't worry about that too much in the beginning. It's more about getting this warp right. So you want to create a three-dimensional twist in the pixels. So that looks quite good already. I think I'm going to work with this. Maybe just drag that down a bit more, something like that. And now we can zoom closer and try to get better alignment here. So if I, for example, start dragging this down, that aligns the socks. Here I can use this point here and align the white lines in the socks there. So this is already slightly better. Something like that. Then we go up to these details here and we can again try to align it on the top. try to align it here as well. Don't worry about the details on the left because we will mask those out later. It's all about matching these lines. So the nail should be where it is there. I can also curve it up. That works better. The hair is in place. These lines are in place. Maybe just slightly above. Okay, that's it. These lines are in place. So that looks quite good to me. I'm going to press enter to accept this transformation. Sometimes it might take a while before it actually creates this twist, especially if you're working in high resolution images. I'm happy with how it looks, and this is why we created a smart object to be able to go back and amend the twist or the warp. So if I use Command or Control T again and switch back to the warp option, see it remembered exactly the mesh that we used. If you don't use a smart object in the first place, this is going to be a completely new bounding box and it will be very hard to align things and refine it. So that's very important in the whole process to do it. Next thing I would do is to add a mask. So just click on the little pixel mask icon here at the bottom. And then we use the brush tool and just very quickly paint over the left side. Now you can decide whether you want to keep these in between details visible or not. I like to get rid of them because that just creates a better silhouette. So I like to keep completely the left side free. And in this case, I would even keep the hand free. I mean, like keep it like this. And I only have the stretch coming after it. You could always do that even as a separate stretch, just coming out from the head and another one from the hand if you wanted to. But I'm not going to complicate it too much. I'm just going to make sure that this is here filled in. So when you go too far with your mask, just press X on the keyboard and paint it back in by using white. By choose black height. And this is very important. If you have a mask directly on your stretch layer, you won't be able to go back to the warp because the mask is preventing it. So what I normally do is to use a group. So Command or Control G, and then drag the mask onto the group, which won't make any difference on your mask. As you can see, whether it's up there or here doesn't really matter. But by freeing up the layer from the pixel mask, I can now select the stretch layer directly, use the free transform tool and go back to the warp and I can continue making changes. Yeah, that's better. And then when I go back now, I can just use that mask on the group and mask this detail out. So just to show you, if I have the mask directly on the layer and I try to go back to the free transform, it immediately tells me that it's not possible. So you have to unlink the layer from the mask. And that's why we are using the group. So now that we have the stretch ready, there's only a few things missing to make this look even cooler, and that's to add shadows and highlights. So it's all about the shading from this point on. I normally would start with a new layer, an empty new layer. I will just call it shadows. And then I will clip this onto the stretch layer. So that's Alt or Option click between the two layers, or you can also use Command Option G or Control Alt G. To create the clip. And then on this shadows layer, I'm going to turn that into multiply blend mode. I will use the brush tool, make it bigger. You can use Control Alt, click and drag left and right to change the brush size, drag up and down to change the hardness. Use a big soft brush for this technique and also reduce your opacity down to something like 20% or 10% by pressing one or two on the keyboard. And then I'm going to sample one of these colors, maybe this yellow here, we'll sample that. And then I start painting over. Now, if you just paint over like this, that's also not bad. But what you notice is it's not only going to darken up the details in the back, but also these details here in the front. Now, if I imagine this to be a three-dimensional form, I would want this top part to be very bright because naturally the light would come from above, and then this bottom part to be darker, the one that is being overlapped by the top. So what we need to do is a very simple quick thing. We just need to create a selection and we go back to our lovely pen tool technique that we already used in this tutorial, and I'm going to align these points to make sure that we get a good selection. Yep, something like that. And then come up here all the way following that line. And then we can come down and just create a bounding shape here, something like that. Command or Control Enter to turn this into a selection. And now we just use our brush and paint over it. I'm going to set it to a bit stronger, so 40%. And you can see how I'm building up the darkest details there at the bottom. And then we can have a bit more shading going on around here as well. Now, if we want to use a darker color, we can pick maybe even black and just add a little bit even more dark details there at the bottom. So now if we zoom out and look at this before and after and turn off the shadows, you can see already how much depth we managed to add just by simply using this. And I'm going to do the same thing around here because I would like to have this little shadow separating our model from the stretch. So that also adds just a bit more interest and depth. Even on the dark details, we can separate her a bit. So once again, without the shadows, with the shadows, just created that nice transition. And let's not forget about highlights. For them, I'm going to again add the new layer. So new layer, clip it on, and I'm going to call it highlights. This one I'm going to set to screen or overlay. We will see which one works better. And I will again use the same brush, select one of these brighter yellow colors and paint over the top of this curve. And we can actually use a bit of this here as well at the bottom. Yeah, just give it a little bit of glow there. But then I'm going to use another layer, same thing, but this one I'm going to set to screen or even like color dodge. I'm going to do this as a spec light. That's the brightest detail on a reflection. And whoever is in 3D would probably recognize these terms. I am going to try to create a nice reflection there on the top. Now I can add a little bit even more in the middle somewhere, but I think I am happy with this. Yeah, just make it glow a bit more, maybe around here as well. We can add a bit more. Okay, so that's looks good. I am happy with that. Now, last thing is to add some depth. Also, we will add the cast shadow. Very simple technique. This is something I would normally do at the bottom. So I'm going to add another layer and I'm going to include it in this stretch group. I'm just going to rename that as well and put that underneath there and call it cast shadow. So on the cast shadow, I'm going to use a darker color, maybe I don't know, black is fine. And I'm going to paint. Now for this one, I'm going to use 100% opacity. And I'm going to just simply start painting from around here and then go to the right. Now you can also hold down the shift key to keep this perfectly straight. And you can add a bit of more volume around here. So what I would do is have a bit more volume here and then less as it goes towards there. But then again, maybe a little bit more volume at the end because of the twist coming forward. So now that we have this, I'm going to use the filter blur, Gaussian blur, to blur it out a little bit even more. Maybe not that much, something like this. And then use the free transform tool to squash it in, holding down Alt and Shift or Option Shift together. You squeeze it together like so, and then you set it to multiply blend mode and reduce the opacity to whatever you feel like is a good natural shadow detail. Because she is quite far away from the ground, I'm going to keep it very soft, the whole shadow, and we could run even another batch of the same blur on it, just to blur it out even more. So normally the closer an object is to the ground where the cast shadow is created, the more sharp it would be. And the bigger the distance is, the softer it would get. So if it was really far away, I could even pump up the blur, maybe up to something like that. But I'm going to keep it in between somewhere around here. And I think that's fine. So now if we take a look at this, we could maybe move the dancer and the stretch slightly higher. And that creates a quite good composition. So I hope you found this tutorial useful. And if it was a little bit fast, don't worry, you can watch it again. And don't forget to experiment with different images. And this is, again, one of those techniques that when you look at other artists, you will see it used in a lot of different ways. So it's completely up to you and how creative you are to then turn this technique into something new. So experiment, as I said, maybe you can try different stretches or some stretching going in a different direction. They can overlap each other. And then you can start combining it with type, the type also twisting into something together with a character or an object. So I'll let you explore this. And if you create something that you use this tutorial for, please make sure you tag us. So hashtag yes, I'm a designer, whether it's Instagram, Twitter, or wherever you post it. We would love to see your work, and we will also feature your work on our own channels. And also important, please use the comments. If you found a cool image and you would like to know how it was created, challenge us and we will try to turn it into a tutorial. Thanks a lot for watching. Like and share this video if you enjoyed it. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon to get notified whenever we release new videos. Click on the link on my right and start your membership today to get access to over 200 hours of training courses and personal mentoring by me and my team of creative professionals. Have fun learning, guys, and I will see you in the next one.